Hi, everybody, and welcome to The Shepherd's Voice with Dave Long. Well, thanks a lot for stopping by and watching our little video series here. We just completed a Kickstarter campaign, and now we're getting back to the business of making videos till Jesus comes back. Anyway, you saw the titles go by. I'm going to run those again at the end. And they mean that you can contact us by mail, by email. We also have access through Amazon. You can get in touch with our book resource there. We ended up part two of this series discussing my leaving Southeastern and Florida Southern colleges purely for reasons of doctrine, conscience, and not wanting to waste my time and money in future paths I could see no profit in, for me or for God. Not profit in money, certainly there was that, in seeking those ordinations and degrees, but in profit of attaining to an earthly position that I felt God and myself would be pleased in my capacity, in my office of a denominational pastor in either the Assembly of God or the Lutheran Church in America. I kind of booted them both. How's that working out for you? But still, I was not imprisoned in an Assembly of God pulpit with certain things that people were believing I was going to push, or the Lutheran Church in America pulpit, certain things that they would not want me to talk about. So, you know, when you're not inside a denomination, you are free to go with your conscience. But then, of course, that's a much rougher way to go than just having a pulpit ready for you to take over. Like the Morristown Lutheran Church in Pennsylvania, just outside of Nazareth, when I was talking to the bishop of our synod, and when I was ready to go into a Lutheran seminary, he was thinking of, his words, sticking me there. Not a bad church. I mean, you know, a fairly medium to large-sized congregation, a little older facility. I would have just knocked the socks off of it. We would have had to bulldoze the thing practically from the inside, leave the outside wall standing, and get it into a modern. I'm sorry. I have a little thing in my throat today, and I don't know what it is, and I've been working on it. I have a mold problem in this house, and I think it might have something to do with that. My sinuses get stuffed up, and there is, you feel like something's hanging on your tonsils or on your vocal cords, you know, and I know it's not. Oh, and there's a big fly over there. But we just started this thing. This should be funny today, just to see if I make it through this thing, so. Hang out. I'm not Lewis Black, and I'm not Jim Gaffigan. Well, you know, if you would take me as what kind of a personality of a pastor would I be, and I know that right now I'm teaching theology on the internet here, and as far as I know, I'm way more advanced than something you get from the Lutheran Church or the Assembly of God. Sorry about that, but I've spent my life doing this stuff, people. But anyway, if you kind of take Gonzo, zealous minister, and mix him in with George Carlin. Remember George Carlin? He was a comedian. I loved him. I know he said a lot of bad words. And so does Lewis Black, who I also love. They say a lot of bad words, both of them. But George Carlin was a very smart, intelligent, bright man who would succinctly cut through the crap and get through the nonsense and said a lot of very intelligent things. You may remember him from, if you were small, you can remember him. I think he had an album called AM and FM. Hilarious. I loved his work. George Carlin and Lewis Black is another guy I admire, as you probably can tell. I picked up a couple of his mannerisms and a little of his delivery. I'm sorry about that. I apologize. Louis Black, you know, he's political. He's very political, and he's a cut through the crap type of guy too. And really, as I sit down and watch myself and analyze myself in talking, I'm thinking, you know, if Billy Graham, in America, for Christ, for Jesus Christ, we want you to come down that aisle right now. See that? My voice is cracking in the upper range when I put anything behind it, because I'll tell you what it is. We don't have adequate drainage around the foundation walls. We get some water and moisture in the basement. And these little blue, green, black things start popping up all over the ceiling. And then, thank God, the people who lived here before ventilated the cellar to the main floor by putting in registers. So, we're breathing all that moldy air. Yes, we got it for a song. The person who owns this house picked it up for probably half what it was worth, because it was just in awful disrepair. Anyway, so all that by way of saying, I'm going through adjustments in my delivery and in the way I want to do these things on purpose. I'm tired of doing... First of all, I got to read a note to myself. Keep the microphone down. Low, physically, not volume-wise. So, okay, if you see me putting the microphone up here like this and almost eating it, bad. Because the sound's going to be really crappy. And I want to keep the microphone down low physically so I don't overload it. And I want to stay in my lower voice register. I think that's much healthier for my voice. And I got it written down over there, but wait, hang on, I'll read it to you. I can't bring the paper over here. Okay. Why? You distort the sound and the microphone is overloaded when you don't keep it at the stomach level, especially when you speak with emphasis. Thanks. You're doing a great job, Dave. Keep it up. Maybe even consider pulling a mic farther away when you get louder. And stay... Okay, and... All right, if I don't do this right tonight, this is your fault. I'm putting this all on the people watching. You have to remind me to do this right. Keep the energy up, keep the microphone low so I don't distort it from it being too close. And here are my notes that have just been blowing all over the place. Got the air conditioners and fans running. Of course. Hey, you wear a camel hair jacket in a living room in the middle of summer, you're going to need some AC. So, okay. Now, let me read this to you fast so you can help me out. Be my assistant. Maybe even consider pulling the mic farther away when you get louder. Stay in your lower voice register. Breathe from your stomach. Using diaphragm and throat, not from your upper... Not from your upper head and sinuses. When you forget or get excited, you go into your Mickey Mouse range. It sounds weird and not as pleasant as a nice modulated baritone. It also gets the ladies' attention. Thanks. You're doing a great job, Dave. Keep it up. not that I'm trying to get the ladies' attention. That doesn't sound right. Not that I'm trying to get the guy's attention either. How do I get out of this one, Myrtle? have a sip of that lemon juice. So anyway, what do you do when you get that thing? Like you feel like you gotta clear your throat and it doesn't happen? Is it milk? Is it me drinking milk? Paul Schaefer in the band, everybody. Paul, should I not be drinking milk? I really need a Paul Schaefer over there. That would be great. Anyway, I'm going to try to cut through this. This is going to be like an author reading a manuscript. Because you know what? I just, it, I'm sorry. You know, I can do, well, I did 33 pages in 2 days here of writing. I mean, that's what I'm looking at here at the notes. Don't worry. We've already cleared through a lot of that. We're about halfway through. We're not going to do 33 pages of reading right now. And I'm going to try to be a little more informal. Because I think the gospel should have the best of everything. Why should the gospel be presented to people in a dull, monotone, boring, exegetical, homiletic, hermeneutical, you know, boring. Okay? Nobody reads PhD papers, okay? Just other PhD people who hate them because nobody likes to see somebody else published if you're in the same field. Anyway, I felt God myself would be pleased in my capacity with either the Assembly of God or the Lutheran Church in America. I didn't get a peace with either one because the Assembly of God believes things I don't. And they cut down and make fun of certain pastors that I respect and I read their books and I like what they say. The Lutheran Church in America, they're in their own little bubble. They don't acknowledge a lot of modern teaching, for want of a better word. Word of faith, miracles, you know, if there's one thing that's true about me, mark this down. One thing I am in favor of, and that's that miracles are for today, now. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's not a man that he should lie. And it's in the Bible, it's in the book. And he's also not the son of a man that he should relent on his word. And I don't know how many dozens of times Jesus Christ made the example that he's passing his power down from himself to anybody who's a believer. The priesthood of the believer. That's a Martin Luther concept. And we're not talking about just going and preaching the gospel. Talked about last tape. You can't do that. Okay, pastors? Stop it. If you're one of those pastors, I don't care if you're Baptist, Assembly of God, Methodist, or Lutheran, or Catholic. If you're out there and you're telling people, yes, it's scriptural to go and preach the word. Go and preach the gospel to all the world. And you're chopping the sentence off right there. You're lying to your people. Because it's one sentence. Jesus said it. No part of the sentence dies out. It doesn't say that anywhere in the Bible. Only experientially did things change because the church cooled off. They stopped being in the temple every day, being taught by the apostles every day, worshiping and praising God every day, and now they've got word, word, word. People preaching the gospels. And the word knowledge puffs up, but the spirit builds up, okay? So the time you're spent in the Word of God, praise God, you are building your faith. But to keep in the Spirit of God and the anointing and the power on you, that comes through praise and worship of the living God, being in association with Him. I think it's Psalm 40, verse 16. It basically says, if you want the presence of God there on the spot to deliver you, praise Him loudly, celebrate Him, worship and praise the Lord. Thank God for music ministers. You know what? I'm going to say something very controversial here, and I stand by it. I think in today's church, the most valuable person standing up front in front of you is the music minister. Because they are the ones that usher your spirit into the presence of the living God to be able to receive miracles. True, they don't do leadership in prayer. That's on the pastor's side. The pastor presents the word, and he's in charge of prayer and seeking God, presenting the petitions before God. But you can't get into the gates of his throne room or into his courts without thanksgiving and praise and worship. And that's most easily done by music. And you'll forgive me if I don't sing for you. I sing like a strangled canary. And I've been doing it since I was 5. Singing along with, pop music of the day. Way back when. And my dad, Lutheran minister. My dad was a Lutheran minister of a church of 2,500 members in northeastern Pennsylvania. My dad started me a music collection. He would go over to a department store in Allentown called Hess's Department Store, a 9th in Hamilton, one of the most unique commercial outlets in all of America. And he would pick up 45s for me because he knew I was into music and liked music from when I was a little child. And I was into the technical stuff. I loved tape recorders, and I loved the buttons and the dials and watching the meters go back and forth. And I had tape recorders and cassette decks. And you know what? You get burnt out on technology and changing technology. Right now we're recording on MP4s. We're doing basically digital uploads from a hard drive of a computer. And boy, I'm really over. There's just something about having tape rolling. I love the big old open reel tapes. It was expensive. You know, the machines were expensive, and the tapes that you bought for them were fairly expensive. But you could hold it in your hand. You could stuff it in a closet. It would never crash. Hard drives crash, okay? And who knows how long everybody online that's allowing us to upload Googles of, gigabits of information up there. Who knows how long it'll be till they start saying, now we're going to charge you, okay? You want to keep your stuff on our servers? It's going to cost you. Anyway, to me at the time, the unknown third path would have been to go to Rhema College in Oklahoma for 2 years, which was Dr. Kenneth E. Hagin's seminary for Pentecostals in the Word of Faith movement, and be ordained there by them. Just lost my script. Okay. And that would have made me into an ordained non-denominational pastor of a small local church that I would have had to start from scratch. Much like Bill Gates, who started Microsoft, Steve Jobs, who started Apple Computer, David Hogan, the Mexican missionary, and others, I felt college curriculum was so much mental masturbation and a giant waste of everybody's resources and time and money, for me, for God, for the students who sign up in good faith. But certainly this is not true for every person or college institution. Don't take that out of context. I believe community colleges teach real skills and trades. I believe state colleges have many valuable professions taught well. I also believe that arrogant, hubris-filled colleges that are fairly small but famous in their own way are cauldrons for bird droppings and for self-indulgent windbags to become minor kings and achieve a monarchy of sorts on earth in the vast, overblown self-importance of their own minds. And I'm not going to name any of the Ivy League colleges here. You know who they are. And I'm not saying for all people, Ivy League is a bad way to go. But these facilities are famous for offering majors with degrees for which they lack adequate facilities to ever consider offering degrees in those areas in good conscience. Much like world champion swimmers don't come from schools that have no swimming pools. Actors and actresses do not graduate from schools with only wannabe actors for professors, with no hardcore experience on stage, screen, or theater. For the reason Jesus Christ picked blue-collar people for his disciples And Jesus Christ did not pick trained religious men of the Jewish faith, which were called Pharisees. I eschewed earthly degrees and ordination because I felt it was so much wrong doctrine, narrow-minded tradition, and meaningless rote exercises leading men down the path not to fulfilling the great commission of Jesus Christ as spoken in the New Testament in Scripture, but to fulfilling the great omission. And, you know, I didn't want to go down the path and become like everybody else, because sane men know that if you do the same thing over and over, you're going to achieve the same results. Well, look what's out there now. And, you know, Martin Luther was a man who stood up, said, you know what, we're going to do things differently. I refuse to be another cookie cutter and knuckle under to what the Catholic Church and the Pope tell me that I know my heart of hearts is wrong, you know. And he started the Reformation basically from that kind of a mindset that, okay, everybody else may come out of that cookie cutter, but we're going to get what we got now. And people, please, from my heart, take it from somebody who knows. The church in the United States of America, the body of Christ, stinks. It's not doing its job. It's impotent. You're not hearing the entire Bible. It's so split up and divided and out of unity. Why? Because the pastors, you want to know why? You want to know why we're not in unity? You want to know why we have such vast differences? You want to know why there's no power and the church and the body of Christ, which is the church is the body of Christ. That's New Testament. Paul said it, not me. Don't hang me for that or anything else. But that the church and the body of Christ is impotent and it's doesn't have any power. People don't want to go to church. It's a ritual. They don't enjoy themselves. And the pastors don't enjoy themselves. Because of that, you know what they did? You know what they've done? They've chopped the time of the service down to like, you know, you're lucky 30, 45 minutes. If you go to a church service that's an hour long, you're doing pretty good nowadays. And it's a shame because back in the New Testament times, they didn't say, oh no, we have to go to church again. They were excited about it because they were telling each other, they were asking each other, boy, I wonder what God's going to do today. Did you see that yesterday when that guy was blind and was missing an eyeball and his one socket got healed and he got new eyes and he could see? And the deaf guy who was healed last week? You know, and we just all felt the presence of the Lord. But thank goodness, I don't know, we have 2 or 3 hours of praise and worship and of singing unto the Lord. And I could just stay there forever and allow the waves of the Holy Spirit of God and His power to sweep over me. Yeah, good luck finding that today in the United States in any churches. Now, there was a church or two, to be honest, that I went to, which had fairly long, uninterrupted praise and worship services, and pastors who prayed, really knew how to pray, and throw themselves humbly in front of God, in front of their congregations even. They'd do that after the services, and they would pray on purpose, like Jesus prayed when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, with, you know, crying in loud wails. And I'm not saying you have to be emotional when you talk to God. But, you know, it wouldn't hurt for you to actually feel the words that are coming out of your mouth to the Almighty Being who holds your life like a thread. And He's got the scissors. He cuts it. You're gone. Anyway, so my main thesis, what disturbs me, what I'm passionate about, is pastors aren't spending enough time with God, so they don't pass anything along to the congregations. They're the starter motor. If they don't get their motor started and revved up for God, nothing's going to happen. You know, the same broken down, deaf, blind, and crippled and cancer-filled people that have been wobbling into church for the last 20 years are going to wobble into church next 20 years, unless the sickness or illness gets them first. And it makes me angry that with such a great salvation that Jesus Christ put out there, hung on a cross, and I know if you go to most Pentecostal churches, you're going to hear about the blood and each nail and the agony at least several times a year, you know, in sermons. And, you know, nothing wrong with that, but I think we're glorifying the part that the devil did. You know, he hung on a cross for sin, but the devil was against Jesus Christ, and he submitted himself until he got to hell, in the bowels of hell, and sin was paid for mankind. And then he didn't have to put up with any of that any longer, because the prince of the world had been defeated, man had been redeemed, and we should glorify Jesus Christ in the power of his resurrection and the mighty victory that he wrought over sin, death, sickness, and anything that's negative in your life, which goes back to the fall of Adam and Eve. That's what we should be excited about and talking about. Yeah, he paid a horrible price on the cross, but I think pastors put their people into fear, doubt, unbelief, and even they glorify the devil. When you go overboard preaching about the blood, I'll tell you what, I'm going to point out one pastor. I don't think he would mind me saying this because it's true. Benny Hinn mentions the crucifixion and the blood and the many wounds that Jesus got on the cross a lot. I mean, you know, and I couldn't go to see Mel Gibson's movie because it's upsetting. You know, it's upsetting to me. It disturbs me that something innocent and perfect, and that was God who loves us, was put through torture by a rotten, no good, doesn't deserve to have his name said, evil being that Adam and Eve threw over their futures for by listening and obeying him in the garden. Anyway, way off subject there. So we're not going to get through this today. So there's going to be a part four. But we're talking about the church today. What's wrong with the church? We're talking about making decisions. We're talking about being a pioneer for Christ, standing up and doing the right thing and demanding that there be strength in the body of Christ and that we stand up for prayer and seeking God and praise and worship so that we can get into his presence. So we're re-empowered again. And it's very difficult for me to do something like that at home by myself. And I'm really tired of going into churches and getting what they call praise and worships, which amounts to 15 minutes if it's non-denominational or Pentecostal church. If you go into a regular church like a Lutheran church, mainline denominational, Methodist, Episcopal, Presbyterian, UCC, you go into one of those churches, you know, the hymns are scattered. They come here or there. And if you're listening to Lakewood and Joel and Victoria Osteen, they never shut up. I mean, the singers can be out there in the middle of beautiful, taking you in front of God's Holy Spirit Christian song, and Joel and Victoria will come out there on stage and just start yapping away for 10 minutes. Totally just ruin the spirit. But so, you know, we don't have 1, 2, 3 hour praise and worships today. It takes an hour to break through all the junk in your mind and the world and get into the spirit with God. And if you can't sing yourself. You can't play an instrument. You know, sitting at home listening to tapes or something from the YouTube doesn't quite cut it. Like being out there and other believers and the spirits there, the presence of God, and the praise and worship is filling the church air. It's not coming out of your 3-inch little computer speakers. You just can't beat the real deal. If we got in front of God as churches in this nation, and on Sunday morning, if we expected at least 1 hour of worship and praise, of uninterrupted music by the best that our church had to offer, and then had the word, whatever. You know, pastors preach 20 minutes, preach an hour and a half, whatever. Whatever your people will sit still for. And then prayer. After you've gotten into the Spirit because you've been praising and worshiping God, and that's another principle, which I'll probably get into again and again in the future, which is the principle of worship and praise of God is a very powerful weapon. It leads you to victory. Jehoshaphat and the armies of Israel achieved victory with praise and worship and seeking God and strong, intense prayer. When they were being attacked by an army, a vast army, which outnumbered them and was much too strong for them, Israel didn't say, well, it's time to get the Torah out and read the Bible for about 2 hours. That didn't do it. They didn't read the Bible at all that day in that dire emergency hour. What they did was they called a fast, and the entire nation gathered together, all Israel, and men, women, children, and sought the Lord and put their prayer out, their desperate, intense prayer of what they were going through and what they needed from God. And then they heard from God. They got direction from the Spirit of God. Wouldn't that be nice nowadays if God actually could have the power and ability to speak? And this happened in the Old Testament. If it happened in the Old Testament, it ought to be happening in the New Testament, where we're having a problem as individuals or churches, where God can directly speak to us and give us wisdom for the moment to press on through, to tell us how to get victory. And after God gave them direction, so see, first of all, they went in intense prayer and presented the emergency situation of dire need to God and waited on him before him in fasting and in prayer and just in humble seeking of his face and wisdom. And then God gave them his word through a prophet who God's Holy Spirit moved through and spoke through. And the next day, they appointed a choir to go in front of the army, in front of the swordsmen and the weapons carriers, etc. And the soldiers, they had the choir, the musicians. It was rough in Israel being a musician because you were on the front lines. You were like the Marines. And they went in front and sang and worshiped praises to God. The Bible says when they started worshiping, when they started to worship and praise God, God started killing their enemy. He started beating their enemies. When? When they started worshiping and praising God. And that was the Old Testament. New Testament, Paul and Silas in jail, in prison, at midnight, worshiping and praising God. God sent an angel. The doors of the cells were opened. There was an earthquake. They were ushered out of the prison by the angel who sent them safely on their way. People, we're not seeing the supernatural today, not because we don't have enough sermons, not because we don't have enough Bible. What we don't have enough of is praise and worship of God and seeking him desperately in prayer to him. Not a 2-minute, 5-minute church prayer ain't going to cut it anymore. Not if you want to change this generation. Not if you want to bring Jesus back. Let me tell you, if you want, Martin Luther is probably spinning in his grave like a dreidel or a top, if you want to call it, because the church has basically not changed 500 years after the First Reformation. Okay. The Bibles are in our known language. They're in English. We can all read them for ourselves. It's the priesthood of the believer. Each individual Christian has the glory that, as per John 17, the glory that God the Father gave to Jesus, Jesus turned around and gave to the church. Everyone who's a believer today. The glory of God is simply this. I've heard people on TV, you will hear them saying everything about what's the glory of God. What is the glory of God? Let me tell you what the glory of God is. You go into the original Greek, and you go into the roots of the Greek, and I'm standing on the shoulders of people who write commentaries on the Greek dictionaries. They said basically you're talking about the substance and the very essence of what and who God is. That is the glory of God, which was taken from the Father and freely given to Jesus. And Jesus said it in John 17. I'm not saying this. Jesus said it. He said, Father, the glory that you have given to me, I have given to them, the church, the believers. And the glory that Jesus Christ has is now in the church. He was really happy about it because he was leaving things good. He was going to heaven and ascending up after doing his job, after 40 days after the resurrection. And then we had Pentecost, which is coming up here next week. Then the Holy Spirit came 10 days after Jesus went to heaven. 10 days Jesus went to heaven, and the Holy Spirit was not yet here, where Jesus was up there, and he said, I am going to send him, and he will take from what is mine and give it to you. He's going to explain it to you. In other words, Jesus didn't reveal everything to the disciples when he was on the earth because they couldn't understand it or they couldn't handle it. That was the Holy Spirit's job, to reveal everything and to talk to us. And it's all over the Bible. Please don't fight me on this, pastors. He said, everything that I've been doing while I was here on this earth, you will be doing too. No, I'm sorry. Not you will be doing. He said, those who believe, believers, will be doing this also. And that's why he said, go and preach the gospel in all the earth. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out the demons. So, okay, Jesus Christ wants his church to wake up, realize who they are, get in touch with him, praise and worship him, empower the Holy Spirit, enable the angels to work up there by doing some praise and worship to God, and praying, us praying through, and praying till we get miracles. Please, let's not do any more two-minute printed church prayers. It's an insult to the Holy Spirit, to God, to Jesus, to what he did on earth, to the name of the church, to the body of Christ. You know what? I'm going to wrap this up. That's enough for today. I went totally off script. You know how far we got? I'll tell you. 33 pages that I had written here. Okay. I think I did a page. Okay. And we stopped with the reason Jesus Christ picked blue-collar people to be his disciples, not trained religious men from the Jewish faith, which were back then the rabbis who were trained scholars of the Jewish faith, the pick of the pack for knowing, you know, the forerunner to Christianity, the Jewish faith. They were called Pharisees. And he eschewed them because he knew he had to start over from scratch, because they would be stiff-necked and have a calloused, hardcore approach to everything that he wanted to do from what they had been taught. He started with blank slates, started with fishermen. And so I knew that if I stayed in institutions that are established and got it through their seminary and their ordination, I'd be one of the thousands and tens of thousands of blasé, mediocre, impotent churches that are out there today. And it's not their fault. You know, they're just doing what they thought was right. But I can read the Bible, and I know what it says. It's too late. I know what's in the book, and you're not going to change my beliefs. And I eschewed earthly degrees and ordination because I felt I was getting into, my faith was being robbed. My core beliefs and what I know to be right and wrong was being battled against 180 degrees in some of the college courses. And it doesn't matter where you go. You know, you take anything that's been around, any seminary or any Bible college that graduates people into, they're going to get some layer of mold and corruption in the basic doctrine of the Bible. It's just going to happen. You're going to have professors who just, you know, take a 1 degree cut away from the absolute truth, and that's all it takes. And the pastors that get out of there take another degree cut away from the absolute truth. In meaningless rote exercises, you can read books written about the Bible till you're dead and still not have finished them all, read them all. Even if that's all you do from now till when you're dead, you're not going to read everything written about the Bible. Leading men down the path not to fulfilling the great commission of Jesus Christ is spoken of in Scripture. Look at John 17. Look at Matthew 10. Look at Mark 16. But to fulfilling the great omission, leaving out, healing the sick, raising the dead, cleansing the lepers, and casting out demons. Say, Dave, how many dead have you raised? You know what? I'm not there. And it's really hard to push forth. You try being at home alone without an ability to play an instrument or sing in cheesy little computer speakers. You try doing an hour or two of worship and praise. And for those of you out there who are doing that, bravo. You're the ones that's keeping the church alive on planet Earth. And also prayer. You try, even if you're spirit-filled, you know how to pray in tongues. You try running around your house praying in tongues, 1, 2, 3 hours in tongues a day, alone, with nobody in your family thinking that you're on the right track, or they think you're nuts, or your friends don't want to, or, you know, church members, they think, I've got lives, I've got too much on my plate, I've got a household to take care of, kids, I got a job I got to do, you know, and then there's my free time, and I got my marriage I got to be concerned with, you know, so they squeeze God out. And so the church has been petrified and paralyzed for 500 years. We've basically gone nowhere. We've had little sporadic things that happened in, you know, Sousa Street out in California. What was that, San Francisco? We had the Brownsville, quote unquote. You know, there were reports of revivals, intense seekings of God breaking out all over the country. God bless them for trying. You shouldn't get on their backs for them having done it at all. You should get on other churches' pastors' backs for not trying to do that type of same thing. This world would be a whole lot different place if the church would use its authority. And I don't mean picketing and writing your congressman. I mean prayer and worship of God, seeking God's face and getting the empowerment from the Holy Spirit and paving a road that the Holy Spirit of God and his angels can use to change this world for real. So, you know, colleges and seminaries engaging largely in mental masturbation should not say they're helping fulfill the Great Commission, but maybe they should say they're trying to fulfill the Great Emission. Mainline denominations which deny New Testament scripture by their traditions produce pastors fulfilling the great omission, omitting the Holy Spirit, his gifts, and the supernatural. Seeing as how they do a fairly good job majoring in the fruit of the Spirit of God, if not the gifts, it's almost as if they know something is missing, and in neglecting the gifts of the Holy Spirit, they attempt to make up for it by preaching heavily on the fruit of the Spirit, Blah, 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 blah. Boy, you'll hear that coming out of the pulpits of the Lutheran church almost every Sunday. You know, and true, love is a foundation. But you can't have a house with just a concrete foundation. You don't have a building that anybody can live in that's just a concrete slab. And the gifts of the Spirit alone, you know, you can't have a house with just electrical wiring and plumbing and air conditioning. You need walls and floors. So, you know, you've got the basic of love, you've got the fruit of the Spirit, and you got the gifts of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is kind of like the associated superstructure with love. Love, which is the foundation. God is love. You know, it's the rock on which we're all built. It's the foundation of the church. Then the walls and the roof and the 2x4s and the insulation and the sheetrock in the house, that's the fruit of the Spirit. But just having love and the fruit of the Spirit is not enough. I mean, you can have a church and still go to heaven that way. But isn't it a shame in this day and age to not have the gifts of the Holy Spirit, seeing as how they had them 2,000 years ago? And the gifts of the Holy Spirit, boy, those are the, you know, that's the power in the house. The gifts of the Holy Spirit is your lights and your air conditioning and your heating. So not only do you have a superstructure, you have all the comforts of the kingdom in place, the gifts of power. To deny the Holy Spirit's gifts is to deny the power of the gospel. Love is God. God is love. Love is the first fruit of the Holy Spirit. But to limit God's expression to love and not allow the gifts of power, to limit God's expression to love and not allow the gifts of power is like a husband and wife limiting their relationship to smiling glances and acts of kindness and denying the verbal expression of love and the physical expression of love. It's nice, but there's so much more they are missing out on by not using words and having their physical relationship. Again, the gifts of the Holy Spirit being inactive in a church is a lot like the gifts of the Holy Spirit being inactive in a church is much like having a church body which does no evangelism. The faith never leaves the building. The people keep their faith to themselves, and the world never hears about Jesus. That is not to say that every church body is called to be a raging Billy Graham institution of evangelism, but they are called to strongly communicate their faith in their community somehow, by some equal kind of expression of faith to the world. That is, if your gift is not evangelism as a church, you should be out there doing something somehow with the supernatural power of God and the gifts He's given you in obvious physical demonstration. That is, there are five offices in the basic recognized church structure. There's the teacher, the pastor, the evangelist, the prophet, and the apostle. If your church is not doing well in preaching the gospel and evangelism, you should be manifesting a gift of teaching or pastoring or speaking forth for God, from God, for God, in behalf, His behalf in prophecy, not for telling futures. That's not what prophecy is. But prophecy, as it's meant in the offices of the church, the office of a prophet, is forth telling the truth of the gospel. And distilling the Bible out and saying what God wants to be taught that the church is weak in. And the scripture and the breaking ground in the spirit of the community and bringing Bible truth to people that is pushing them forward in their understanding the important principles of faith and the Bible. When Jesus Christ appeared to the Apostle John for what was to be the book of Revelation, when John saw Jesus, and he appeared to him in his heavenly glory. And the glory of God, of course, is the essence. And everything that God is the very substance of Him, which now lives inside of us by grace through faith. But when John saw that, Jesus was in the office of a prophet. He was in his high priest prophetic office. in the book of Revelation, in communicating to the church where their shortcomings were, what they needed to shore up, and, you know, tweaks in the area churches so they wouldn't lose their way, so they'd grow and prosper and not go to hell, and they would help more people come into the church and grow and prosper. He was foretelling Jesus Christ in the Revelation, and he also predicted the future. He's talking about what would happen in the church future, you know, in the end times and the Antichrist and how the devil and the Antichrist are going to be defeated and all that. Certainly that's part of it. But he was operating in the office of prophet right there. And an apostolic church is a church simply which is sent out by Christ in order to reach a new mission field, whether it's in geography on the earth or by a concept of understanding of the scriptures and the Bible. It is a first-time church in Africa. Is an apostolic church, a church which for the first time preaches the doctrine of salvation by grace and not by works in an area, is an apostolic church. In a sense, that would make the Lutheran church, indirectly established by Martin Luther, an apostolic church, because they teach it is the grace of God embraced in men by faith, not our good works. It's the grace of God, not good works, that saves us. And such teaching was new to his time. Specifically, a New Testament doctrine found throughout the New Testament. But that is not what you're hearing in the majority of pulpits in Luther's day. Many pulpits today, you still are not hearing that we get to heaven purely by the grace of God, through our faith, not by works. How many pulpits today still pound the pulpit about the Ten Commandments and the law of the Old Testament, insinuating that by observing these, men are made the righteousness of God through work and sanctifying themselves and industrious discipline to the Christian faith, which is, and of course, here we are getting into the circle of thought that drove the Apostle Paul almost mad in reasoning works versus grace in the book of Romans. Now, at this point in my life, I wonder if it was God or not. Back then, in my decisions, I now wonder about the people I might have networked to if I had kept the faith and kept the shepherd's voice going back then, the effect I might have had on people and what might have grown out of it. But only God knows that truth. Needless to say, I was raised at home with music flooding my existence. And actually, we're getting into some new stuff here and a new turn in where we're going. And I think we've done a pretty good job. So we're going to run to the end here. We're now on page 14. I am so sorry. I get so long-winded, but it's good stuff. Okay. And that was 14 pages out of 33 pages. Martin Luther changed the world, and more importantly, the eternal destiny of souls forever. And this is The Shepherd's Voice with Dave Long. Thanks for watching. Good night, good morning, good afternoon. Thank you whenever you're watching this. I'm assuming on the YouTube channel. And God bless.